But I have to, like I say, make up backstories that besides picking, you know, thinking that Kylo Ren, you know, picking the new Hitler to be the next Hope, that's on me. But there had to be more to me to justify even cutting off my telepathic communication with my sister. So, I mean, but that's my job. I mean, I'm not the one that, and there were practical things, because JJ had a much different vision for what was going to happen in 8. The first thing I said to Ryan is, I said, how are we going to explain me being in my Jedi ceremonial robes when I first meet Rey? You know, things like that, to make sure that, you know, there was a flow.
And the other thing that I think is, I don't know, in the context of how this has all been framed, you have to snap your head back and remember this process happens on every single movie with characters. It's always a dialogue between the director and the actor, and that's a healthy thing. You always put heads with the actors over. Yeah, absolutely. And so it is a fascinating part of this process.
Remember when I called you up and was panting? I said, did they take out the floating boulders?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Because when we were shooting the end of 7, JJ goes, and we'll have a couple of floating boulders to show Luke's force powers emanating from him. And I read 8 before 7 came out, so I called Ryan in a panic. I said, do you know they're going to put in floating boulders? Get them out! Because it won't match your script. Plus, you know, I thought, oh, great, you know, I'm going to have the force oozing out of every orifice of my body in here. I'll be knocking down ATTs like dominoes raising an eyebrow. And I won't even have to train that hard, because I'll just do this. The ILM guys will put the force lightning coming out of my fingers. I trained for 12 months for 7 before I read the script. And let me tell you, I went twice a week, I was never late, and I never canceled. And I would drive to the gym. Carrie had the equipment installed in her house, and still they come to the door and she goes, oh, was that today? Not knowing. She's so Carrie.
So maybe
I love it.
My wording was incorrect. Maybe the best word is...
No, sorry. Finish your question. Sorry, we jumped on it.
Okay. Maybe the best word was confused.
There's a lot of feelings here.
Yeah.
No. She asked a legitimate question.
No.
I complained about having...
Sorry, what was your question?
For 12 months.
It's okay. Maybe my wording was wrong. Confusion, maybe, or... maybe not directly getting what Mr. Johnson was going at with Luke's version. So my question was, if you were in the director's chair, if you were writing the script, what would be your take on Luke Skywalker for this?
I don't
want
to hear this.
Woo! Well, you do, motherfucker. Woo! I told Ryan, I have lots of really terrible ideas I'd like to share with you. And maybe from 1,000, you'd find one or two you'd like. But I was no different with George. I read Return of the Jedi. I said, wait a second. I thought I was heading towards the struggle of going to the dark side. I lost a hand. I'm now dressed in black. I've got a glove. You know, I see the trend here. But, you know, you just have to, you're just an assistant to the chef. You know, he comes up with the recipe. We have to cook it and hope that the audience finds it the most delicious thing they've ever tasted, you know? And hopefully they don't go, ooh, I can't even eat this. So, you know, I'm like a lot of you. I mean, I feel an investment in it. I feel like a certain sense of ownership, which is a joke, because I don't own it. Now Disney does, but, you know, you care, you know? And that's what happens with these, films, you know. I'm sorry I lowered my guard and expressed my misgivings about it, because that belongs in process. That doesn't belong to the public, you know. And I feel bad because I made that statement before I saw the finished film, you know. And I mean, even though I read the whole script, you're working on puzzle pieces and you don't see the whole thing assembled until it's done. And I just think, you know, it's a stunning film. It's challenging. It's surprising. It has humor. It's probably the most complex Star Wars film since maybe Empire. So you know, the thing is,
yes.
You know, again, my job is not to do anything but try and I had to put aside my feelings and try and realize the director's vision the best I can, and you know, what else can you do?
And like I said in the doc, it really comes from the heart, is that the fact that through the whole process, because ultimately at the end of the day, that's, you always are going to have back and forth with every actor about the character, you're going to agree about stuff, disagree about stuff. The fact that Mark gave the emotionally powerful performance that he did in this movie, and the fact that that only comes from completely committing yourself to putting that story onto the screen and to connecting with that version of the character, and the fact that Mark put that trust, I guess, into me, that I mean, it's
even the things that I said, like, well, wait a second, you know, I'm going to burn down the library, don't try and stop me, you know, and then Yoda raises a finger, does it for me, and I go, but that's just sacred Jedi text! Hey, make up your mind!
That's Luke!
But yeah, that's what I'm saying. I said, oh, okay, not only is he a broken man, he's certifiably insane. No, I can play that.
Typecasting. We only have time for one quick last question. I'm sorry, everybody waiting in line.
Absolutely. First of all, thank you guys for coming to Austin to show this. It feels like an absolute dream. My question is directed primarily at Mr. Johnson. I know, apart from the great characters in Star Wars, a lot of us are drawn to it because of the mythos, the Jedi Sith, light versus dark. What did it feel like writing for a movie that in the Star Wars canon some people feel is more like a religious text than it is a movie or a story or a film?
Well, I feel that way too, weirdly. Like, I grew up, you know, and any of us who grew up with this, it's not that just you grow up with some movies that you love. The fact that when you're a little kid, the Jedi and the, you know, the myth of the Clone Wars and the mystery of that and the mysticism of the Yoda scenes, that as a kid especially are genuinely scary, that feeling of power. The fact that that connects up to something within you. I think that, yeah, it does make it scary coming into it, saying, okay, now I'm gonna tell a story in that context. It also, though, I can't imagine doing it if you didn't have that feeling, if you didn't take the Force and the Jedi and the character of Luke Skywalker seriously enough to invest in them and say, okay, what is the actual next step for this in the mythic sense of it, you know? So yeah, it makes it daunting, but I think it also is what allows you to connect up with it. What is happening?
Oh, he's counting all the empty seats. What gives here? I'm counting the house.
I just want to take a minute to point out